Welcome to the webcast. Thank you so much for joining us. I am so excited to be at the table with these two gentlemen, and I just look forward so much to today because it's all about amazing photography technology. Now, we're going to be going through the cameras and also talking to two professionals that are ultimately capable of discussing this. First, I'd like to introduce Gregory Heisler. In addition to the 70 plus covers he has done for Time magazine, Gregory Heisler's portraits have been also featured on the covers of Life, Esquire, Sports Illustrated, GQ, the New York Times Magazine, among others. His commercial and advertising clients include American Express, Merrill Lynch, and Nike, and he has been recognized with the prestigious photographic awards, including the Leica Medal of Excellence and the Alfred Einstein Award. And then in the fall of 2014, Gregory assumed the new post as the Distinguished Professor of Photography at the S.I. Newhouse School of Public Communications at Syracuse University. And of course, he's also the noted author of his 2013 book, Gregory Heisler, 50 Portraits, which is now in its third printing.
That's the rumor.
Yes. Now, tell me a little bit about this teaching position. It's kind of a shift in your career now.
It is. I've been teaching for about 5 years as a more of a full-time thing, and I've kind of made a transition from being a photographer who teaches to actually a teacher who photographs. It sounds kind of funny, but that's actually kind of really what it is. I feel like I've taught workshops for many, many years, and it always sounds funny because it's sort of like, oh, it's wonderful to give back, and it is, but basically speaking very selfishly, it's really gratifying. It
sure
is. It's great interacting with the students. It makes you learn more when you actually have to explain it to someone else, which I do on a daily basis, so it's great. I'm really enjoying
it. Well, and it's also kind of opposite of the old idiom where they say those who can't do teach. You've got the track record now.
Right, and those who can't teach, teach PE. Isn't that what it is, right?
I suppose so. Now, also at the table with me is Rudy Winston. For over 18 years, Rudy Winston has been one of the Canon USA's primary sources in photography and technical information. Currently a technical advisor in Canon's customer education division, his first 12 years at Canon were spent directly assisting working professionals as well as internal staff and training as a member of Canon's technical information department. His knowledge and working experience with Canon's still image product line, past and present, combined with his writing and speaking skills, make him a leading person with Canon USA in the camera division. Now, I have to tell you a little bit of quick behind the scenes. As we were making introductions around and meeting some staff and some of the people that were helping us put all this together, I wish I could take credit for this. Gregory actually said, Rudy is the Yoda of Canon, and it's so true. I've known Rudy for a long time now, and that's absolutely true. So thank you so much for joining us, Rudy.
Well, I'm honored to be here, and thank you both for the kind words. It's a privilege to be here with B&H, and I'm honored to be here with you folks as well.
And we're going to be talking about two very important cameras that could potentially change the way you look at photography and photography potential. But we want to make sure that you're able to participate. So we want to encourage you to participate with this live event using Twitter. And there is a hashtag, and that's hashtag BHPhotoLive. So make sure that you take note of that, and I'll try and remember it a couple of times later on. You're going to be able to send us questions. It's there in the lower thirds on the webcast right now. So BH Photo Live is where we're going to be receiving information from you. I'll try and think of important questions. I do have a lot of questions about these cameras, about your using the camera and your experience. And Rudy, you brought with you a video for us.
Yeah, let's start things off with a short video from Canon Inc. That introduces the EOS 5D and 5DS for those who may not have been up on the basics of the camera just yet.
Great.
Presenting the Canon EOS 5DS. The EOS 5DS brings a new image sensor with more than 50 megapixels. The sensor's increased resolution and the clarity it delivers are eye-popping. Coupled with the EF family of lenses, the 5DS leverages their ability to depict life to the max. Together, they paint a beautiful picture. Of course, saving a high-resolution image not only means raising the quality for greatly enlarging photographs, but also offering plenty of margin for altering the final output, too. So even after trimming, images can still be used as new compositions. However, the greater the resolution of the sensor in the resulting photo, the more obvious even a little camera shake is in the image. So with the EOS 5DS, we made a number of improvements to dampen vibrations inside the camera to the minimum and limit their effect on the image. To give the camera more overall rigidity, we made some major design changes, from switching to a super rigid resin for the body to beefing up the base plate and reinforcing the tripod mount. We also gave it a mirror vibration control system. The EOS 5DS utilizes a cam mechanism for controlling the vertical movement of the mirror. It controls the speed it moves and reduces vibration from moving up and down. The EOS 5DS uses all these new mechanisms to get the most out of its high-resolution image sensor. What is produced by high-definition photographs? The beauty of photographic expression. Now, in your hands.
Welcome back. Now, I would like to start off with these gentlemen, and let's just talk about these new cameras, the 5DS and the 5DSR, and you've had a chance to shoot with them a little bit, and you've had a chance to shoot with them during their pre-announcement days, so you've had some hands-on with them for quite a while. Let's talk a little bit about the cameras themselves. What was your initial experience when you very first got that? Because you regularly shoot the 5D Mark III.
5D Mark III, yeah.
Yeah. And so when you got the 5DS and the 5DSR, what was your initial feeling?
I thought they were faking me. I thought they sent me two more 5D Mark IIIs. It looks exactly the same to me. It's black. It matches everything I use. My camera kit, all the lenses. No, it was actually great. They, for those of you who are used to working with the 5D Mark III, it's going to feel very familiar, layout's very similar, the camera body's basically the same. So that was kind of nice. And I was just very curious to get my hands on them and curious to see if it actually would be a big difference just from handling the cameras and a shooting standpoint. And I really wanted to get my eye really on the files to see, honestly, if I could see a difference, if it was a big deal.
And we're going to get into that and, and talk about the differences and the experience. So your initial shooting experience was similar to what you expected.
Well, I mean, that was nice. I thought there might be kind of a learning curve, but essentially it's the same thing. So that's kind of good.
Rudy, there's been a lot of excitement about these two cameras. And the announcement was several months back, and now they're actually shipping. That actually started, I think, yesterday, technically. So they're actually shipping, and so you need to place your order now. I have my order in. We'll see when that shows up. But my question to you is, this has been not only anticipated since the official public announcement, but inside Canon and really in the photographic industry, it's been anticipated for quite some time.
Absolutely. High resolution is something we've gotten considerable demand for over the years from many different types of critical users. You know, certainly from the folks that do landscape work, studio photographers in commercial fields and such. Those were two big areas where we got demand for higher resolution products than what we've had up to this point. But these really, I think, are going to raise the bar for many different types of shooting, not just the person who's working with product in the studio, not just the person who's shooting landscapes on a tripod out in the wilds. And they do certainly bring us a great deal of excitement to our lineup.
Well, and I think one of the things that people need to also understand is Canon brings this to the market because Canon is responsible for the development of the sensors as opposed to, you know, there are a lot of other pieces of gear, I guess, that are kind of from multiple sourced.
And Canon is responsible for their own sensors.
Yeah, for many years, that's been a source of great pride for us, that we have made not only our own CMOS sensors and digital SLRs, but even the fabrication machines that make those sensors are Canon products.
I want to buy one of those. I want to have it in my, I want to make my own sensor.
That's the camera maker makers.
Like an 8x10 sensor. That's what I mean.
So certainly to have our sensor being the heart that beats within this product is a big thing for us.
It's incredible. Now, I know that you've also done another video, and this one is a little over 4 minutes long, and it digs a little bit deeper, and this will kind of set the foundation so that the rest of the conversation that we're having makes a little bit more sense. So we'd like to show you one additional video.
These are two cameras that emphasize tremendous fine detail and image resolution. A couple of points about the 50.6 million pixel CMOS sensor on these cameras. It's identical on both the S and SR models. And as a point of comparison, the size of each individual pixel on this sensor is about the same size as those on the sensor of an EOS 7D Mark II. In fact, the only difference between the 5DS and the 5DSR model is that the 5DSR cancels the effect of the low-pass filter to give us a little more sharpness in some situations. This means that the SR model may be even better suited for photographers requiring maximum sharpness and detail, photographers shooting landscapes, certain type of commercial applications, and so on. Where you'll see the difference is a slight increase in edge detail, the detail in fine lines, and certain types of texture. Now, the added sharpness from this removal of the low-pass filter effect on the EOS 5DSR, there is the added risk of occasional moiré patterns or false color in some situations, such as when shooting fabrics or subjects with fine repeating lines or patterns. Because of this, we think that many photographers are going to regard the 5DSR as a specialized version of the EOS 5DS. Now, as we launch the EOS 5DS, a very important point is to understand that it does not replace the EOS 5D Mark III in the Canon product line. We understand that not every Canon shooter has a need for super high pixel resolution. And for those photographers, the 5D Mark III remains a viable and practical alternative for many different types of shooting. When we look at the 50 million pixels the EOS 5DS offers, the numbers are staggering. It's more than twice the pixel resolution of the 5D Mark III. It gives us files with tremendous ability to reproduce fine detail and texture. This is going to be an outstanding camera for large prints, for photographers who are into wide format printing. With absolutely no resizing or interpolation of this camera's files, at 300 dpi, it'll produce nearly a 20 by 30 inch print, again, with absolutely no interpolation. Now, the high resolution sensor in the 5DS also gives you options for cropped shooting in the camera. You can shoot square images, you can shoot into images with a 1.3 times crop, or match the size of the sensor that's being used in our APS-C cameras, like an EOS 7D Mark II, for instance, with a 1.6 times crop. In that latter setting, the 1.6 times crop, you still have 20 million pixels of information with longer effective reach if you need it. Another great feature is the intelligent viewfinder in the EOS 5DS. It gives virtually 100% coverage, and it includes two different types of indication for cropping, for the 1.3 times, the 1.6 times, and square crops. You can have either lines for your cropping, or you can have the area being cropped completely masked off. There are several new changes in the body to minimize the impact of vibration within the camera, and that's very important in a high-resolution camera. These include a totally new motorized mirror mechanism that cushions the shock of the mirror going up and down without lowering its speed, and stronger base plate on the camera, stronger tripod socket to minimize the impact of vibration when the camera's tripod mounted. And finally, mirror lock has been refined. So we not only have traditional mirror lock as a menu setting that you can pick, but you can also pick a variety of settings that delay the shutter action after the mirror rises, giving the camera a chance to settle down from any harmonic vibrations, ranging from an eighth of a second to 2 full seconds after you fully press the shutter. For Canon USA, I'm Rudy Winston. Thank you for joining us.
That should help you get a pretty good foundation for what to expect in the conversation that we're going to have. Now, let's dig into some of these details. And we've had some preliminary meetings. Obviously, we're doing a live event, and so we had some planning meetings. And I've talked with both of you guys about your experience with the camera and the technology. And Gregory, I want to start with you.
Okay.
And let's dig into the actual experience. I've seen some big, beautiful prints that are fresh off the press.
They are hot off the presses.
And so let's talk a little bit about what you got in your shooting experience.
Well, actually, I guess for me, there are two things I wanted to figure out. One was I wanted to see, frankly, if I could actually see an appreciable difference between, an improvement in a sense, between these cameras and the 5D Mark III. The 5D Mark III is kind of like my go-to workhorse, does everything camera. And it was kind of a miracle when it came out, so I'm hooked. I use it all the time.
Sure.
That's what I use. That's one thing. The second thing, there are actually three things. The second thing was I wanted to find out what the subtle differences were between the two different cameras. As a potential purchaser, I wanted to figure out which one I would get. And then the third thing was I also shoot a lot of medium format digital. And I was really curious as to whether or not these would actually approach medium format quality. Like, would that ever replace the medium format camera I have? So those were kind of the questions I was looking to answer for myself when I was doing it. The test I did was really quick. I'm normally a pretty thorough tester. That was what I used to do all the time in my studio, days when we weren't shooting. Believe it or not, there actually are days when you're not shooting as a professional photographer. And what we would do on those days is test out lighting, test out cameras, compare lenses. We used to do that stuff all the time. So being very thorough about this stuff is important, and I always felt that I just like finding out for myself. I'm not going to ask somebody, like, what do you think of this enlarger instead of that enlarger, or this lens instead of that lens. Like, I want to try them out. I want to see what I like, just to see. My preferences might be different from someone else's. So, and also, I know how I'm going to use this stuff or what the results are I might want to achieve. So I took these out, and instead of, in a sense, doing a very controlled studio test, which would be a little bit more scientific, I actually wanted to see what they would look like if I actually took them out in a real shooting situation. So I should tell them this is kind of funny. So I got the cameras like Wednesday, and on Thursday, I think it was, I was trying to figure out what I would want to shoot with them. Thursday was kind of like my day. And I remember driving by in Syracuse, Performance Harley Davidson, the dealership. I've driven by many times, and I always thought, yeah, I bet they've got some cool stuff in there. So I literally just drove there. I figure if I call them on the phone, they'll say no. So I just went in there and said, you know, I have to test out these new cameras. I need something that's got a lot of detail. A, can I use one of your bikes? And B, can you suggest any of your friends who might be really into getting their picture taken? It'd be kind of cool. Instead of like photographing a 17-year-old model, I thought it'd be cool to get somebody who's got some character. It'd be fun. So the guy said, actually, yeah, this is bike night at Sharky's. And I was like, bike night at Sharky's, yeah. So everybody's going to be there. You can come. So we went over to this place that evening, a couple hours later. And I set up and did a portrait of this one gentleman who I went up to with some trepidation. And he was super nice. And I asked him if he'd pose, and he did. So the idea was to actually get a picture where I could actually, the camera could kind of sink its teeth into some good detail, ultimately. Like if I photograph, you know, a 1 second exposure of a seascape on a cloudy day, there's going to be nothing to sink its teeth into. So I wanted something with lots of little details. So I photographed him. It was not a perfectly ideal situation because I didn't maybe have the sturdiest tripod. I was using some longer exposures as the sun was going down. But ultimately, that's how I shoot. So I figured we should see how it really looks. So I tried it out. I actually tried out 4 cameras. I tried out the 5D Mark III, my go-to camera, the 5DS, which is the one that has sort of an anti-moiré suppression filter, is it filter?
Yeah, low-pass filter.
Low-pass filter, technically speaking. And then there's the SR, which does not have that filter, and theoretically would give you a bit more detail, a bit more, sure, more resolution. And then on top of that, I have my medium format camera with me, which is an old Hasselblad that has a Leaf Aptus 54S, which is like a 5 years old digital back, mm-hmm, but it's still my favorite.
Okay.
I like it for not so much about detail, but sort of, to use a subjective word, like creaminess, a kind of creaminess you get to the tonality, which I really like. So that's what I did. And I set this up and switched out the cameras and looked at the pictures later, and then actually the next day went into the studio and did sort of like boring tests of a face so I could look at eyelashes on eyeballs and stuff like that. Actually, the eyelashes wouldn't be on the eyeball, they'd be just ahead of the eyeball.
Fairly close.
Close, with great proximity to the eyeball. But, and did that. And sort of what I came away with very specifically was that the difference between, this is the key for me, takeaway, for the way I shoot, is the difference between the 5D Mark III and both of these cameras is sort of a whole order of magnitude of resolution, right? So if you look at these images at 100%, you'd actually have to take the 5D Mark III image and make it 200%, sort of, to have a similar image scale. Once you do that, that image breaks down.
Sure.
It just doesn't hold. That was the beauty in the old days of film, is film would get grainier as you made a bigger and bigger enlargement, but it didn't deteriorate in a sense. It just got more of what it was, right? With digital things, once you hit a point, it starts getting unhappy pretty fast.
Right. Right?
There is a sort of an upper limit. So here the bar's been raised. That's kind of the beautiful thing. So that was a big jump, and it was like, oh, okay, I see that, pretty clear. Then between these two cameras, the difference is much more subtle, I think. The S, which is the one that does have the low pass filter, is still like crazy sharp, right? Like for my 61-year-old eyeballs, it's pretty good. I think it looks pretty good. And it's clearly, again, a whole big step above the Mark III, 5D Mark III, right? The SR that doesn't have the low pass filter gives you sort of a little bit of an edgier, a little bit finer detail, a little bit crisper, like you'd see it in nostril hairs and eyelashes and
sure,
edges of blades of grass and things like that, detail threads of a jacket, things like that. And you see it. That is not a night and day difference, in my opinion. That would be more a matter of what suits the kind of work you do, right? So the whole moiré thing, for people who don't know what moiré is, it's sort of this sort of rainbow weird pattern that you get when a very fine pattern that's in front of the camera could be a herringbone suit, it could be
right,
a backlit hair, something's very fine. The scale of that interferes with the pattern of the pixels on the sensor.
Sure.
And you get a funny thing, like when you see two screen doors or
exactly,
something like that, and it gets all weird. It's sort of like that. The thing that's funny about moiré is you only see it when it's too late. You
yeah,
see
you
when
were
the
talking about this earlier,
yeah,
and you said that it's only during post-processing, and that can be awfully frustrating.
Yeah, it's like, surprise, I've got a present for you. So it's a bummer. I mean, that's the way it goes, is that because you're generally not looking for it when you're shooting.
Sure.
If you're shooting a job and you're in a studio and you're working with the digital tech and somebody's really eyeballing every frame that comes in at 100%, somebody might alert you to it and say, gee, we're getting a little moiré here. Mm-hmm. And at that point, instead of just running around and weeping, which I used to do, I basically back off a couple of feet or go in a couple of feet. And just that subtle change of scale, making the picture person, the subject a little bigger, smaller, will usually deal with it.
Okay.
That's an easy way to deal with it. The thing is, though, that generally, if you're shooting, you just don't notice, because you're not paying attention, you just don't notice it. And then you're looking at it big on the computer at one-to-one like we all do. That's when you see it. The other issue, which is I think is just a funny thing, is as digital photographers, because photographers, we all want to see all the little bits and pieces, is we all look at our pictures at 100% on the computer. The first thing we do. Right? So you're looking at it magnified like crazy. We were talking about this earlier.
Sure.
In the film days, you'd shoot 8x10 film, and you'd put a 4x loop on it, and it would be magnified. If you looked at it, in a sense, at 100%, you'd be seeing like molecules. I mean, you'd be seeing stuff that you'd never looked at a piece of film that closely. You just didn't do it. So this is a very different way. You're actually looking at things that, in a sense, you'd never pay attention to, but now we do. That's just the cold, hard fact of it. So I think what you see is that very subtle difference in sharpness, very fine. The other thing I did is I compared these, all three cameras, with this leaf back, right? Keep in mind, just as an additional consideration, a price thing, you know, what it costs. So medium format cameras, $6,000, $8,000, $10,000, $12,000, it's a bunch of money.
Sure.
Then there's the back. It's like film. It's extra, right? So the digital back, they can start now that some of them are like at $12,000, but mostly they're kind of like $20,000 and up. $20,000 for the back. So it's like digital back, new car. Digital back, new car. Like, you're gonna think really hard before you buy one. I bought mine used. I'm a successful guy. I buy used ones, you know. So I bought mine used, and I did it after talking to actually a chip designer. I tested out all the different digital backs a couple of years, 5 years ago, whenever it was. And I went in and said, like, I'm gonna buy one of these digital backs. I wanna try every single one for an hour. I'll do it right here. But I wanna see, I just wanna see. Mm-hmm. So for me, surprisingly, the 22 megapixel back was not the biggest at the time. To me, the image looked the tastiest. It looked the smoothest. It had detail, but it had like very creamy sort of tonal gradations. And for portraits, it's more what I'm interested in.
Right.
Right? If I'm shooting landscapes and I'm shooting blades of grass, resolution might be more important. If I'm shooting architecture, might be more important. There's all kinds of things. For me, for portraits, that was more important. And the detail was still terrific. So I have a comparison here that I did, close up of my subject's eyes, just his eye. And we did that, and basically you see it with all the different cameras. And what you do see, and it's interesting, I think, is that the 22 megapixel medium format back picture and the 22 megapixel 5D Mark III picture are different.
Sure.
To my eye, my preference is for the medium format one. Mm-hmm. To me, it looks creamier, it feels a little sharper, it feels more like continuous tone. It just looks nice. Once you make the jump to these guys, though, then it surpasses the 22 megapixel medium format back in sharpness, and it's just a whole like other level of quality up. It changes. The net of that for me is that I now would use the medium, literally this is up 2 days ago, and I promise I'm not saying this because Rudy's here. It's like, as of 2 days ago, I would be more hard pressed to think of the reason to use the medium format back, because at that point it would become just a creative choice, like, do I prefer that slightly smoother tonality at a cost of degree of enlargement, that kind of thing. And the difference, I think, also is like people say, oh, you know, if you're shooting billboards or something, you need a big, you know, large format thing. Mm-hmm. Billboards are huge, but you're 100 yards away and you're driving by them at 60 miles an hour. It doesn't have to be that detailed. You're not even going to see it, right? Where you do see it, though, is in a gallery.
Exactly.
That, like, people see a painting, the first thing they do is step back to get a sense of what it is. The first thing everybody does with a photograph is they get their nose prints on it because they walk right up to it and they want to see every little detail.
And we all did that when you unwrapped your prints here today.
Yeah.
And thank you so much for bringing these big, beautiful prints. Mm-hmm. These are the result of that testing that you did.
That exhausting 27 minutes, yeah. That's what it was.
Well, I think one of the strongest statements here is that you're not just somebody who has occasionally shot a medium format camera.
Right.
You shoot your medium format camera.
Yep.
And you've done it as a working photographer.
Yep.
And now you're looking at a different tool.
Yep.
And it is so different.
Yep.
And you were talking a little bit about that. So what's your take on that?
Well, I sort of come to this stuff from pre-digital days. Initially, I thought digital would be like a passing spell of bad weather and it would go away if I ignored it, but it didn't happen. And before this, I mostly shot medium format 4x5 and 8x10 for portraits and even some 11x14 film, right? So I really like working that way. It's a very methodical way of working, very deliberate. I really like that. And also, people tend to shut up and sit straight when they see a wooden camera. It's kind of a cool thing. But these, it's a whole different thing. Like, even if I'm in love with my medium format camera, I'm not going to have a 17 to 24 lens for my medium format camera, right? I'm not going to have that. And so all of a sudden, I mean, to me, this is a big deal. I can have these, right? I can have a 17 to 24, a 24 to 70, and a 70 to 200. And like this camera, like this little situation, that's sort of like everything. Like I've got
it. That's incredible.
I actually shouldn't leave this off. I get spanked for this. Hold on, let me put this lens back on. Sorry. Hang on just for a minute.
This time.
Sorry. It's a self-cleaning sensor though, right? So
that's right.
It shouldn't matter. So like I can fit this in a purse and I have like everything covered. I have a 50 megapixel camera from 11 millimeters to 200 millimeters. You know, it's crazy that, and the quality that you can get. So that's amazing to me. And you'd have to be pretty hard pressed to want a very specific way of looking at things, of seeing things, to want it any different, right? The deal is though, there's been a lot of talk about, gee, you know, if I get this camera, am I gonna have to kiss all my old lenses goodbye?
Right.
Because, you know, I spent $10,000 to $15,000 on a camera, like what am I supposed to do? Like now the computer guys come up with a new connection. Yeah, that kind of stuff. Except more expensive. So I was curious about that. And you sort of have a choice, right? If you use the latest, greatest, it's those lenses will take full advantage of the sensor, right? As much as the sensor sees, the lenses will be up to the task and maybe see more.
Okay.
That's really cool, right? In my large format days, I had like six, in a sense, the equivalent of six 50 millimeter lenses for my 8x10 to be a 300, be a 12 inch lens, right? They were all normal lenses, but they all had different personalities. Some were sharper, some had lower contrast, some were a little bit, not soft focus, but a little less edgy, in a sense, and they all had different qualities, right? If those lenses, in a sense, didn't really resolve to 8x10 film, but they looked awesome. So for me, like I have for my medium format nameless camera, I adapted old lenses to fit that camera. I have this one called, literally, it's a Zoomar. That was the brand. It's a Zoomar. Jamie Azell told me about it. And it's a 90 millimeter macro lens that literally like screws out to there. It's kind of crazy. It's not high contrast. It's not the sharpest lens you've ever seen. It looks awesome. If you put lenses like that, right, like you could put a lens baby on here. If you put a lens like that on here and you're actually going for the effect of it, what this camera will let you do is make a bigger print before the pixel part, the digital component degrades. It's not like you see the flaws of the lens more. It's just that because you're making the image bigger, those things, I don't know if they're even more apparent. It's just that you can now make it bigger. So if the lens is soft, you'll see it.
Sure.
If the lens isn't razor sharp, you'll see it.
Well,
but it doesn't, it's not in a sense, I don't know how to say it. It's not the lens's fault. It's like it's
sure.
Allowing you this option to do that. And I think that's, like, I think it's
well,
good.
Well, it that is. Would, and it addresses a little bit of one of the questions that I have is, who is this camera for?
Mm-hmm.
And when we're thinking
me.
About that,
camera's for me. Come on.
Of course it is. Of course it is. But when you think about who is the camera for, it sounds like it's for more people than just the pixel peeper
mm-hmm.
who needs the minutia of that high resolution. It sounds like craftspeople that have access to those older traditional lenses will still be able to appreciate what they get from those legacy lenses
mm-hmm.
on a different level.
I mean, literally, I don't know who makes them, but there's folks that make like literally a pinhole body cap for this camera, so it becomes a pinhole camera. It's not going to be as sharp as the 24 to 70 millimeter ultrasonic L2 USM super fancy lens, but what it will do is it will give you this enormously enlargeable, very deep, beautiful, lovely image to work with a pinhole camera, right? So to me, that's like, okay. Wow, that's pretty cool. Like I no longer have to put that on a big camera.
Okay, but that's almost sacrilegious. To put a pinhole on that camera, that just hurts my heart.
I do it just to spite Canon, just for revenge, I do it, just because I can.
Now, I realize that the audience that's watching us today mm-hmm. may not be into the high geeky kind of levels of technology that we all are. And one of the things that is the difference between the 5DS and the 5DSR, mm-hmm. and you've alluded to this, mm-hmm. is there's going to be a bit more sharpness and detail on the 5DSR. Mm-hmm. And that's because of the lack of an optical low-pass filter. Mm-hmm. Rudy, I want to talk to our audience a little bit about the optical low-pass filter. It's just showing up on the radar, really, in popular photography these days. And so let's talk about what is it there for traditionally, and what is it doing or not doing?
Well, we've, in the industry, not just Canon, the industry has had what we call low-pass filtration on digital cameras, including digital SLRs, for quite some time. And basically, the reasoning for it goes back to something Greg hearkened on, and that is the possibility that in some cases you can photograph subjects with fine repeating lines or detail, and you have that little mismatch where things just kind of don't quite line up with the array of pixels on your sensor, and you can end up with these sort of psychedelic looking moiré patterns. The engineers figured out that if you take the incoming light and apply two low-pass filters to it. And what that means is basically if you had a single ray of light, it's going to be split into two, and then you have two rays coming in now.
Yeah, and we actually have a graphic, an illustration of this.
Right. And it gets split into two a second time. So you're splitting the light, separating it by the width of approximately one pixel. So it's obviously happening at a very minute level on the imaging sensor. Obviously, you're taking one ray of incoming light and you're splitting it slightly. There is a slight softening, or if you will, blurring effect in doing that.
On like a micro level, right?
Right.
Pretty much, yeah. Mm-hmm.
But as a trade-off, you will tend to minimize the incidence of these unpredictable moiré patterns. I don't want to overstate the risk of these moiré patterns. It's not like something that happened all the time. Mm-hmm. In actual use, even with cameras from yesteryear, they're the exception rather than the rule. But as Greg very aptly pointed out, when they happen unexpectedly. You don't see it in the viewfinder. Mm-hmm. So that's what we've done with traditional low-pass filtration, Canon and other makers. What the 5DSR model does is it also has to have two low-pass filters. And I can explain why in a minute. But what they wanted was the sharpest possible starting point for photographers when they pull an image off the card. So what we do is we split a single ray into two with the first filter, and then the second filter refocuses it back, so it then hits the imaging sensor back as one single ray. People may say, well, why cancel the low-pass filter effect that way? Why not just simply remove the low-pass filters altogether? The problem is they are part of the optical path, and if you simply remove them, you change the internal dimensions of the camera by a very small amount. It doesn't sound like moving the imaging sensor a millimeter or thereabouts would make that much difference, but the problem is you would then have to readjust and reposition components of the autofocusing system and the viewfinder system. In effect, you'd have to design a new camera body. So considering that we were basing this on the 5D Mark III and our engineers made the determination that we wanted to give photographers two options, two high resolution options, one with a very user-friendly file, the 5DS. Mm-hmm. Because it does minimize the risk of moiré in those rare instances. And then also to give those extremely critical photographers a little bit sharper option. So they made the decision to do the two and to have low pass filtration in both. But again, in the case of the 5DSR, one filter splits, the other filter repositions it so that we're canceling that low pass effect. And we preserve, in effect, the same original sharpness we'd have if there were no low-pass filters in place.
Okay, so that is a whole lot more than I actually expected. I learned an awful lot there. So it's cancellation of the optical load.
Exactly. And I want to point something out quickly, because I actually got a couple of phone calls in the office about this. When we say cancellation of the low-pass filter effect, a lot of times in digital photography today, we hear the word cancel, and we think, oh, there's a menu function, a custom function that we can just, you know, turn on or cancel. That's not it.
This is true optics.
This is in the optical pattern, and you can't change it.
Now, one of the things, Gregory, that I wanted to talk to you about is you are known as a 5D Mark III shooter. Mm-hmm. And so you did this comparison with the 5DS mm-hmm. and the 5DSR and the 5D Mark III. Mm-hmm. And what I'd like to know is, and you're not making the decision for the world, but with your experience.
I want to. I have the power.
But of course you do. But with your experience and the type of photography that you do, and you're looking at these cameras, I have two questions. Does this replace your 5D Mark III? Because I know that Canon says, no, it doesn't replace the 5D Mark III. How about for you? And then also, further down the road, 5DS or 5DSR for Gregory Heisler?
Well, here's the deal. If somebody were holding a gun to my head and I had to pick just one camera for everything, to walk around with, to shoot jobs with, to do video with. We haven't really talked about video yet. Do video with. Do everything. And to make pretty good, pretty big brands, I'd stick with a 5D Mark III.
Okay.
Because as an all-rounder, it's like a go-to. That's for me. Now that this exists, though, I won't be able to sleep at night. So for me, what I'm going to do is actually upgrade to the SR, which is the one with a low pass, an anti-low pass, a re-low pass, and a double reverse triple low pass filter that basically gives you the ever so slightly sharper image, just because for me that's what I would want. And so I would use that camera. Is this the one? Yeah, I would use this camera, the SR, probably for like 90% of what I would do. I would have the other one, the 5D Mark III, as the backup. It would be great. I could do the video. We should talk about the video thing. If I just wanted a camera that was a super high resolution camera and I wasn't a psychopath, like I am, I would probably pick the S, because the S is just a little bit less risky in terms of the moiré. We shouldn't overstate the moiré thing, though, because that's like, it happens, it never happened with film, because film doesn't have a grid.
Sure.
Film's random. The grain is randomly dispersed. What do they call it in stochastic grain? That's what they call it, I think. But anyway, it's random. So there was never a pattern for stuff to interfere with or line up with. Once you get into digital, there is this grid. There is this array of pixels. So it's not a common thing that you even have moiré. Because these cameras are so super crazy resolution, in order to see moiré, you will only see it when the pattern is crazy fine, like super duper duper duper. Like if I'm taking a picture of Rudy at this distance wearing a herringbone suit, I'm probably not gonna see it, although I might have with a 18 megapixel camera mm-hmm. 8 years ago, maybe. With this camera, Rudy has to be waiting for a bus a half a block away, then I might see it on him. Do you know what I mean? It's 'cause all his details are that much littler. That would make a difference. So the likelihood that you're going to even get it isn't huge. And the difference is subtle enough between these two that basically, for a camera you could use and just not have to worry about it a whole lot, mm-hmm. to me you'd get the high resolution aspect with the S, and you wouldn't have to worry about that much at all. Like if it's only 2% of the time or 5% of the time or 10% of the time that you'd ever see it, which I doubt if it would be, then it's like 1% or half of a percent or something. And even then, just to be fair, it doesn't actually go away. It's dramatically reduced.
Okay.
So it's not like putting on the invisibility cloak
sure.
or something. It's just, it's there, but really harder to detect. For me, though, my fantasy kit at this point would be the SR and my 5D Mark III, for me. If I had to pick one, because I'm not super into video at the moment, maybe it would be the S, because that would allow me to be a little bit looser with it, a little more relaxed in a sense when I'm working with it. A question I have for Rudy, though, I was actually wondering about this because I didn't have time to test them out for video, is in a sense, if I'm using either of these cameras, and I do want to do video, am I actually losing anything? Like, is the quality of video the same? Is it, like, was anything sacrificed to get the 50 megapixel thing?
Not so much in terms of the 50 million pixels in the resolution, but there are a couple of video features that the serious video shooter is probably going to miss when they're talking the 5DS and 5DSR compared to the 5D Mark III. 5D Mark III has a headphone jack for plugging in a headphone to monitor incoming sound. We don't have that on the S and the SR models. And also, 5D Mark III, let me express myself clearly, has the ability through the HDMI port, if you connect it to a third-party video recorder to record uncompressed video, clean video, directly to a recorder. The S and the SR, for technical reasons, don't have that capability via the HDMI port. Now, the person who's just shooting, you know, the quick video for YouTube or whatever, probably not gonna miss that kind of stuff. But the person who's a serious video practitioner, those are reasons that they might still wanna stick with the 5D Mark III.
Mm-hmm. If they actually want to have super high resolution video, in terms of resolution, do these sensors give them any advantage over the Mark III, or do you have to move to, what's the one that's the video one?
We get into the Cinema EOS camera.
Or the
1DC, yes.
Yeah.
The engineers have said that there is a slight increase in final overall video sharpness at full HD, that's 1080p, with these cameras. Now, obviously, 1080p is a mile from 50 million pixels per frame. We know that.
Right.
But they're saying there is a slight quality increase in terms of just detail and resolution in the final product with the 5DS and 5DSR. So that in and of itself might be something for that serious video enthusiast to at least compare. But we're not claiming that there's any huge difference in video quality stepping from a Mark III to a 5DS series camera.
Yep. I mean, I would think what that might leave me with, since you're talking about it that way, is in a way, if I just had to have one camera and that was it, it'd be the 5D Mark III because it's just versatile and great and work great and it's fine and the files aren't huge and it's an easy thing and it works for video and it's friendly. If I wanted to have like the super duper crazy quality then, as a videographer and as a still photographer, then my guess is A, I would start saving my pennies, and B, I'd probably want the SR for the crazy sharp still, and I'd probably want the 1DC, which we're not even really addressing here, which is kind of like the upgrade video upgrade, 4K, jazzy, cinema-friendly video upgrade that's kind of looks like a 1DX, I think, doesn't it? It's kind of like
yes.
That, but a little bit bigger body. So then you'd have like a kick-butt video camera and the crazy sharp still, those might be two interesting things to pair up in terms of having that kind of level of quality where you think, I've really got the exact perfect tool for each of these things.
That's a great point for the demanding user.
Yeah.
That the EOS 1DC might be a great sidekick for video in particular, or for just high speed still shooting, because it is based on a 1DX. You can still shoot your 18 million pixel still images up to 12 frames a second with that camera.
With the cinema camera?
With the 1DC.
Oh, no kidding.
So that's a very interesting piece. I know we're here today to talk about the 5DS and the 5DSR, that's an excellent point for that very discriminating user for whom the money isn't that big a factor.
Yep.
One other thing I'd like to point out, in terms of the still shooter, just bring the conversation back to that for a second, is that, you know, the highlight, of course, of these cameras are the 50 million pixels that they record at full resolution. But a very neat feature for people who shoot raw image files is the practical application of your medium raw and your small raw settings, your reduced resolution raw options. You have the ability, if you want to with these cameras, to go to medium raw and shoot a 28 million pixel raw image, original image.
Is that a cropped sensor?
No.
Does it crop into the sensor? What's it doing?
It has that capability too, but that's separate.
Okay.
That's a different feature. Here we're talking about just simply using the full frame area of the sensor, but we end up with a file where the information has been simplified from 50.3 million pixels originally to either 28 million pixels at the middle raw setting or 12.4 million pixels at the small raw setting. Mm-hmm. So I've made the point before that somebody, for instance, who was a wedding photographer, these are great options because you can take things like your reception candids and that kind of thing at 12.4 or 28 million pixels. Think about it, at 28 million pixels, you're talking roughly 25% more pixel information than a 5D Mark III will do,
right.
But you're still not talking about, you know, really extremely large files that are going to take up lots of storage space and stuff. We understand that not every situation calls for 50 yeah. million pixel files. But one of the cool things about these cameras is that, you know, you basically can use them as practical modern cameras at the 12.4 or 28 million pixel settings for a lot of applications and know that you have in your back pocket that ability to switch to 50 million pixels when you really need that detail.
Yep.
Well, and one of the other nice things about that is that the camera itself has two memory card slots, an SD and a compact flash, and you can simultaneously shoot at multiple resolutions.
That's a great point.
And send one to each of the two cards. And Gregory, while you were talking about video, mm-hmm. it made me start thinking about the time-lapse function that's a part of the new 5DS, 5DSR. And how is that different from like other types of multiple exposures that have been in previous Canon models?
Well, for instance, on the 7D Mark II, very successful camera with a smaller APS-C sensor, we introduced an internal interval timer in the camera so you can take still pictures at set intervals. And
so
many
don't need
people
the extra thing, the extra
right, you
that,
don't need
you
the
don't
accessory
need
anymore. You, uh-huh. you can use it, but you don't have to anymore.
Right.
And one application that many photographers asked for this for was the ability to bring those files into the computer and to create time-lapse movies, finished movies, but you had to do it in the computer. 5DS and 5DSR are the first Canon cameras where you also have a separate feature when you're in movie mode to do a time-lapse movie. You define the length of time between frames. You can define the total number of frames up to, I believe, 3,600 frames. And the system will tell you right on the menu how long a finished video will, how long it will take to record the video and how long that finished video will run at standard 30 frames a second. And when you say okay and then press the button, it starts shooting those frames and it'll process it in camera into a finished full HD video file. So you can do those things of the clouds racing past a mountain or whatever, again, without having to go to the computer after the fact. So that's a neat feature.
We actually have a video produced by this exact feature from this new camera. Let's have a look at what was shot in Tokyo. Welcome back. You know, of course, this is all about these giant images, these very big, very detailed images, and you were gracious enough to bring some, and we've actually got them here, and it's incredible. I cannot express to you, and there's just no way that what you're seeing here, we've tried with some of the examples that we've shown you guys in the video, in the machine that we do the best that we can.
Gizmo, to I get prefer it.
Well,
Gizmo.
It's TriCaster, so okay. Right. So in the TriCaster, we've tried to get really close on a lot of these images and show you detail, but there's just nothing like experiencing it and getting up close. And this shot that you can see right now is one that Gregory shot. This was the Harley Davidson at Sharky's. I have to ask you a question. Did you wear a bow tie at Sharky's?
I did not, but I left my leathers at home.
Yeah. I was just picturing you going up there with the bow tie on going,
I'll tell you, I've done it.
Have you really?
I have. I wear it most of the time. I do.
Okay.
Well, I do.
I would imagine that would get a different reaction at a biker bar.
It's actually nice. It does. It does. You'd be surprised.
But the print itself, there is incredible detail in this wall, and so you actually chose this location specifically because of all of the detail. So would you tell people a little bit about what was going on around it and why you picked this spot?
Yeah, it's actually funny. I got to this place, again, haven't been there before, drive up whenever it was, 6:30 at night, and it's a restaurant bar kind of place, perfectly nice, and in Liverpool, just outside of Syracuse. And drove up there, but it looks not great, and there was sort of like a little tent set up with a band playing, stuff like that. But again, wanted something that had a lot of detail, so I just did a quick 360 around the building, and in the back, kind of to the right of side of that picture, is sort of like the dumpsters and loading dock. And to the left side of the picture is like a hose with a nozzle where people spray themselves off after they've been playing beach volleyball. So you sort of squished in the middle, but right in the middle there was this sort of bamboo-y mat thing that was hanging there.
Incredible detail.
Yeah, I thought it'd be something for the camera to sink its teeth into, and also the details on the bike and stuff. But it was kind of funny because we're staying in front of this really nice place. It's like, where are you going to take the pictures? Like, well, come around back. We sort of walk around the back, and it's pretty dumpy. But it looks awesome for the picture. It worked out really, really well, which is cool. You know, it's funny when you can crop in. One thing I was just thinking about when we were watching that video, it was on the break, is a big deal with a big file that you get. Kind of one thing people are talking about is like, yeah, but look at these giant files. Like, what are you getting? 50 million pixels, but what, it's a big file when you process it out. The thing is, for me, for example, I'm used to the big files from using 50, 60, 80 megapixel medium format backs.
Sure.
Those are even bigger files, right? So for somebody who's shooting stuff like that, that's not an adjustment. It's like, oh, okay, yeah, no, I've got big files, that's what I do. And so you have fast computer, bigger storage, stuff like that. And of course, over time, that stuff gets cheaper anyway. But
right, we actually have a question from one of our viewers. Andrew Souls, AF Souls, asks, how big is the raw image file size on a 5DS compared to a 7D, 6D, 5D? Is it slow to load? And what about working in Lightroom?
Yes.
Perfect.
Next question. No, sorry. I'll defer to Rudy for the specifics on that.
Okay. First off, every click of the shutter when you're shooting a full 50 million pixel raw file with a 5DS or a 5DSR puts about a 60 megabyte file onto the memory card. So your .cr2 raw file on the memory card
is
about 60 megabytes in size. It can fluctuate a little bit, but it's roughly 60 megabytes, give or take.
Yep.
Now, just so that you know, open that up in Photoshop. Photoshop sees 144 megabyte file size for the image you've opened up, and that's at its 8-bit setting.
Right.
If you're working in 16-bit mode in Photoshop,
megs, yeah,
then it's a 288 megabyte file.
Right. Yep.
And if you just simply did nothing more than just say save and selected TIFF as your file format, you'd have either 144 megabyte or a 288 megabyte file. Obviously, those are pretty staggering numbers compared to what we're used to.
Right.
The gentleman asked for a comparison to some of the other cameras. All the other cameras are hovering around 20 million pixels, give or take. The 5D Mark III, of course, is 22 million. 7D Mark II is 20. The 6D is 20, and so on. And so I don't have all the exact numbers, but basically, a raw file out of one of those cameras, the .cr2 file on the memory card, it's going to be about 25 megabytes in size, again, give or take a little bit. Mm-hmm. And they're going to open up, obviously, significantly smaller in a program like Photoshop.
Yep. And one thing I would say is I was looking at these initially on a pretty juiced up a Mac laptop, and the pictures opened quickly in Lightroom, and it wasn't an issue at all. And when I went to, the place was actually making the prints. They had an older Mac, a regular desktop Mac.
Sure.
And it did take a while in that. I think that's more dependent upon the power of the computer that you're using, mm-hmm. for sure. It will obviously be, the bigger the file, the longer it's going to take. But my point is just that on a current model, sexy, nice computer, it goes pretty quick, and it's not, so much so that I didn't notice it. On that one, though, I noticed it. What I did notice, and tell me if this is true, Rudy, I actually don't know for sure. Because I was unprepared, and because I was doing it sort of the seat of the pants when I was shooting at Sharky's, is I had some SD cards with me that were old, and I think, I'm curious as to whether this is true, they weren't the latest, greatest, fastest memory cards, and it seemed like when I was in these two cameras that they actually were slower to write. Does the card itself matter?
Oh, yeah.
It does.
When you're shooting RAW, and in particular, if you're trying to shoot images fairly quickly, one after the other, and you don't have to be a sports photographer to be in that situation, card speed does begin to matter. Uh-huh. And the slower the card writing speed is, the longer you're going to have that flashing red light on the back, the card busy light, saying, hey, we're still busy here, we're still writing to the card, still writing to the card. So, yeah, that's a factor.
Does it matter if you have two cards? Is one quicker than the other? And also, I've always been curious about this. CF cards are bigger and more expensive. Are they faster than little SD cards?
They have the potential. They have the potential to be faster. Uh-huh. So a high-end compact flash card and a high-end SD card, in many, many cases, the high-end CF card is going to have a little bit better performance. Uh-huh. And the camera, if you're using both, the camera can only perform as well as the weakest link in the chain, so to speak.
No,
probably a bad analogy. Yeah. But that means that if you have a slower SD card, it's going to slow up the total performance of the camera a little bit.
Okay.
Modern cards, I haven't seen too many problems with these cameras. So it doesn't have to be like the latest and greatest and most expensive from whatever your card company of choice is.
Right.
Okay, so I got to pull you back from the tech.
Yeah, it's just so much fun. I never get to talk to Rudy
You're getting your tech help, but I want to show people some of these images. You've got some photographs of eyes that have come across incredible. There's nothing like seeing them in person.
Yep.
But we do have them in the system so that the audience can actually see some of these images.
Yep.
And it's amazing the detail. One of the things about this particular image is that it's three-dimensional when it's in person. I mean, on the printed piece, it just pops off that flat surface.
Mm-hmm. I mean, what was interesting to me when I promise I'm not saying this because Rudy's here, I promise. When I actually saw it for the first time on the laptop, when I actually saw it blown up, I kind of couldn't believe it because it's sort of like no matter how much I zoomed in on it, that's the thing with a photograph is like, that was why I used to like shooting large format is in a sense, it never lets you down. Like as close as you want to go, it never lets you down. For digital, that's always been a bit of a disappointment to me because I get close to a print and it starts letting me down past a certain point, and you always want to get close. When I looked at his eye in this thing, you could actually see not just his iris, but you could see the fact the inside of his iris actually curved in. It was actually 3D. So that was like, do you need that? Is that important? No, it's just it's an indicator of what you're seeing that's pretty astonishing. That kind of stuff is really amazing to see. And that, like, when I'm looking at that, that could be somebody's eye, that could be a field of wheat, that could be bricks in a wall, that could be a texture in a suit, that could be, you know, like, anything that you want to see. But it's sort of as
So as a creative, and you're looking at building, you're building a finished image before you click the shutter.
Mm-hmm.
And you have a new tool now.
Mm-hmm.
And so as photographers and as photography students, we often listen to your training, your information, and we try and understand your vision. And we also have come to understand that tools are a big part of the process. It gives you that much more capability. Mm-hmm. So with respect to that, do you think that your vision will change or your opportunities will change because of this added resolution?
Yeah, I mean, I think it's a bit, honestly, like middle of last week, the night after Sharky's, after I was shooting that, I actually had an idea for a series of portraits I think I'm going to do over the summer. We'll see. And it was a series of portraits I was thinking of doing going back to my big cameras. And I'm kind of reconsidering it and thinking that I actually might do it with this guy, the SR. And I want to figure out for this what would be the absolute crazy sharpest lens that I could possibly get for it. And that's the thing, I got to stress this one more time, is sort of where it makes the biggest difference, where you'll see it is obviously on the computer, but in the print, right? I did a cover a year ago, about a year ago or so, for Sports Illustrated that was Boston Marathon. It was called Boston Strong. It was a year after the marathon, the sure. bombing. And it was a group photo of 3,000 people. I did a group photo of 3,000 people. That would have been a picture I would have done 10 years ago with an 8x10 for sure. We were shooting from like a cherry picker from a platform. And I was using the 5D Mark III, right? And I asked the experts at Canon, like, what is the sharpest lens I can use, kind of wide? And much to my surprise, they said the 17 tilt shift in the middle. They just said, like, that lens has incredible coverage and it's crazy sharp in the middle. So that's what I used, right? The actual cover of the magazine was taken as a vertical crop from a horizontal picture with the 5D Mark III. And you can see threads on the shoelaces of the kids standing in the front and bricks on the building that's like half a block away.
Incredible.
Right? So that's, like, you can get that kind of detail for sure already at that scale. Right? If I want to take that picture and make a 30 by 40 print of it, then it won't look as good. Does that make sense? Like, I think
sure.
for something that's going to reproduce 8 by 10 or 11 by 14, you're not going to really see it. You won't. I think for something where you actually are going to blow it up and see it more, or see it displayed on your computer, however you want to do it, but particularly for a bigger print that's high resolution, that's where you're going to see something that's going to be mind-boggling. For sure.
Well, and I'm looking at it as, for people like me, one of my strengths is not building the image or designing the frame in advance as well. I know other people see better. Mm-hmm. I see better after the fact, and most of the time, having that additional detail allows me to reframe, recrop, readjust,
a little bit, yeah.
and I can crop in and look a whole lot better than I really am in reality.
A perfect thing. I think that's good. Don't tell anybody. Your secret's safe with us and the 10 million people out there watching this right now.
Rudy, one of the things that that came up in the brief technology video is that there's some other new technology in the camera, and vibration reduction is critical. This is a highly detailed camera. You were talking about always shooting on that most stable tripod, and then now there are some new technologies and timings. Can you tell me a little bit about that?
Yeah, and I'm glad you brought that up, Larry. A couple of points. First off, all this added resolution and detail we've been talking about, there's no free lunch. And one of the sidebars is that if you are going to look closely, the slightest little imperfections in technique or whatever are going to show up more readily in terms of as visible imperfections in detail than they might have with previous generation cameras that were progressively lower in total pixel resolution. So our engineers realize this in the development of this camera. Camera shake is certainly one issue. Now here, I'm not talking so much about hand, well, that's a fact too, of course, is handheld shake. Mm-hmm. But let's just assume we're mounted on a tripod. We still have the issue of slight harmonic vibrations being caused by the mirror movement of the camera, and even by movement of the shutter blades. What they've done is they've totally re-engineered the mirror system in this camera, going from a system that was basically spring-powered to one that's completely motor-driven. So the mirror movement up and down is motorized by a motor that they can vary the speed to control, to slow it down as it reaches its apex and as it falls down to reach its bottom position. And there's a unique cam drive system that helps with cushioning the shock at either place as well. The chassis of the camera was intentionally significantly strengthened so that when it's mounted on a tripod at the camera body, that the camera is much less susceptible to so subtle kind of guitar string, if you will, vibrations that could happen with previous generation cameras. And the other thing too is that we know that self-timer application is another tool that can further reduce the risk of subtle vibrations to the serious and extremely critical shooter when you are working on a tripod. So we've not only got conventional mirror lock in this camera, but we've also got timed mirror lock, and it's a menu-driven system where you can tell the camera, hey, once you fully press the shutter and the mirror goes up, delay the actual opening of the shutter anywhere from an eighth of a second to 2 full seconds. So to give the camera a little time to sort of settle down. And that applies whether we're working with the shutter button or whether you've plugged in a remote control of some kind.
That's not great. For the decisive moment, though. That would be like the decisive 10, 15 minutes.
Well, you make a great point, though. And that it opens up a broader question. A lot of people, I think, are hung up on, oh my God, my technique has to be perfect. I always have to shoot on a tripod. I have to use mirror lock or live view. I have to do all this stuff and maybe shoot completely differently than I have been before. That's not really the case. It's just if you want to get the absolute best detail, if you're the type of person that is going to blow up every image on screen 100%, 200%, and you can't sleep well at night if every picture doesn't just look absolutely like the best thing you've ever seen, yeah, you're going to need to really keep an eye on your technique. Things like minimum shutter speeds, selecting apertures that are not too small. You don't really want to stop down below about f8 or f11 if you're after the maximum critical sharpness, and so on and so on. But this camera can work perfectly well in a handheld environment, even with telephoto lenses. This camera can work perfectly well as an action camera. A lot of people have pigeonholed it as, oh, well, you can't use it for action. It's just for landscape and for studio. Nonsense.
But the nice thing is that you have the tools there for any aspect of that creativity that you like.
There you go.
Guys, we are moving along in the event, and I want to move to some of the questions that we're getting from our Twitter audience. And so at this point, this question is for you, Gregory. The question is, what is the single biggest feature about the EOS 5DS that should excite a fellow portrait photographer? And that's from Mike H.
Mike, I would say it's nostril hairs. You have never seen nostril hairs rendered with such loving, intricate detail
as you
will see with this little pup.
I guess
it's kind of like what I was saying before. I think that ultimately what's going to be really lovely is the smoothness of the file and the enlargeability of it. That's what's really, really nice, right? That's where you will see it. The thing that's important to understand, I think, as well, kind of basing on what Rudy was talking about, is that each person has to use this camera in his or her own way. You have to try it out. Because in the end, you can take all these precautions, particularly if you're a portrait shooter, but it's like the operation's a success, but the patient died. Do you know what I mean? Like,
sure.
You had it the right thing, you had it set on a tripod, it was drilled into cement, like it's all great, but you're not getting pictures that you like anymore. So there's no point to that. And I think you have to find what the trade-offs are, what works for you, what you can live with, all that stuff. And that's going to be different for me than it is for Rudy, than it is for you, than it is for someone else. So I think that's really important. For me as a portrait person, what I love is like when we looked at that picture and we saw the guy's eyelashes, it's a funny thing. If you care about eyelashes, you will love this camera. It's sort of like what you don't want is a mushy eyelash. Mm-hmm. Do you know what I mean? Like that's something that you know needs to be fine. Do you know what I mean? And so to me, you could say it's an eyelash, you could say it's the edge of a button, you could say it's threads in a coat, you could say it's the brim of a hat, you could say it's lots of things, but it's, and again, there are millions of great photographs that have been taken since the beginning of time that are soft, that have motion, that are evocative, that are moody, that aren't about sharpness, clearly. Even those pictures, if you shoot that kind of work, it will be scaled up better. That's the important thing to keep in mind. You don't have to be a detail freak to benefit, in a sense, from that. That, to me, was the important thing for me. Because not every picture I have, like I might use a gentler lens. I might use a vintage lens mm-hmm. on here simply because of that scale I can get, not for sharpness. but for
scale. So it's about that scale. And I've heard you in your teachings say idea first and technique second.
Yep.
And this fits, dovetails beautifully with that.
Yep. And again, like what you were saying was perfect. I feel like it's another tool for your tool belt. Do you know what I mean? And I think that it's like what's wonderful is being able to have the option. You know, someone else might look at this and say, you know, that sounds awesome, not for me. Mm-hmm. Cool. I think that's great. You know, I mean, you could live a full and happy life and never take a picture of this kid. It's like, fine. You know what I mean? What's wonderful is like, oh, if I'm interested in doing that kind of thing, I'm interested in that kind of print, and these things are meaningful to me, it exists. It's a wonderful, and you don't have to have $80,000 and a big camera to make it happen. That's a pretty cool thing.
Sure. We have another question that is, why is it exciting to be able to print larger prints or get more detail from your images in the artist's, from the artist's perspective? And I wanted to let my crew off stage know that I see yet another question, but it's one we've already answered. So we're going to ask them to move on to some others. But what about getting more detail in your images from the artist's perspective?
Well, I mean, from a crass commercial perspective, as I understand it, you get paid more for big prints than you do for a little prints. So whether you should, I mean, seriously, whether you're...
Has that ever happened with you?
The inverse. It freaks people out. They don't know what to make of it. A wallet size of mine's like 20 grand, basically what it is. And it goes down from there, basically. No, I mean, what happens is whether or not you're shooting portraits, like family portraits are going to go on a wall, generally, the bigger you can make it, the more you can charge for it. Not always, but oftentimes in a gallery setting, it's a similar thing. For the most part, as a rule of thumb, big prints cost more than little prints to purchase. So, and also in contemporary photography, particularly in color contemporary photography, the trend is towards bigger prints. Back in the day, you looked at silver prints, and they were 4x5 and 8x10, 11x14. A big print was 16x20, and actually bigger than 16x20 for black and white print almost look kind of commercial and funny. Mm-hmm. It was no longer like fine art in a way. You know what I mean? So now it's a big change. So I think in that way, being able to make a bigger print's a nice thing. And also some people prefer not to print, for example, on canvas.
Sure.
Because you get more detail. Sometimes canvas is good because it kind of hides those imperfections. Here you could actually print on glossy or very smooth paper and actually benefit from that if that's what you choose.
Very good, yep. Very good. So in your bag, I can expect in 6 months, this is pretty much the kit we're gonna see along with the 5D Mark III.
It's all up to Rudy. I would say.
Done deal.
Yeah.
I'm looking to see if we do have any other questions from our social media. And then one of the other things is you brought a copy of your book and we're gonna have you sign that on the air. So I want to make sure that we get your book over here. Guys, bring the book over. It's okay. You can come on camera. There we go.
I have to know how to spell your name. To whom it may concern right now. So this is it. Available on Amazon at your friendly bookstore. Gregory Heisler 50 Portraits. It's a bargain at twice the price, let me tell you. And yep, it has lots of stories behind the pictures, some technique stuff, but it's not technique-y. So hopefully it's about the thought process. And I hope you would enjoy it.
And while you're signing that, would you, Rudy, answer this question? This is for Canon USA regarding, do you have any plans to update the camera firmware with new features in the future? Now that's something that I can't imagine that you could actually answer yet, but my experience, what I always tell people, is that it seems like there are more Canon updates to software and hardware, the firmware, than any other model out there. So if tradition holds...
Well, you know, as a great man once said, you play with crystal balls, you sometimes end up eating glass. So...
Wait, I'm writing that one down.
I don't want to go on record with speculation about what may happen down the road, because it truly would be, quite honestly, speculation and nothing more. It's always a possibility. And I think one thing people have to remember, firmware, of course, is the software within the camera that basically controls many, many of its internal operations, at least in a digital camera. And of course, in today's SLR world, we can upgrade that firmware and in some cases fix minor bugs, and in other cases actually add features and so on. But the point I want to make is that for us to be able to update a feature, it has to be something that is upgradable with software. Mm-hmm. It can't be something that requires a hardware change. Mm-hmm. That would require, usually, a new camera. Mm-hmm. So people have to sort of separate the two. And sometimes things that seem like, oh, well, you could just add a menu option to change this button to do blank. Sometimes, from an engineer's point of view, it's not quite as easy as just rewriting a little bit of code. Mm-hmm. So that's kind of a long-winded answer to your question. And I understand it's not really giving you a concise answer. But I hope it does give an impression as to why sometimes you see these kind of changes hit the board. And other times, you may wish for something and there is no feature change. Mm-hmm. And that can be why, because software alone couldn't address it, or couldn't address it fully.
Can I ask you a really quick question? I was just thinking about this. I actually don't know the answer, and maybe folks out there do. If I'm looking for super-duper detail, and if I want the thing to be rock solid, and if it's on a tripod, am I better off using image stabilization or not when I'm on a tripod? Is it like a belt and suspenders, or is it actually counterproductive, or how does that work?
That's a great question. We get it all the time.
Do you? Oh, okay.
And generally, because it does, the answer can vary a little bit depending on the lens, but in general, our recommendation is just turn the stabilization off.
When you're on tripod?
When you're on a rock solid tripod.
Oh, okay.
You put it on, I'm not gonna name brands, but you put it on a big, professional tripod that isn't going anywhere, mm-hmm. and there aren't railroad trains or trucks going by that are shaking the sidewalk and such. That's the time to just turn image stabilization off. Mm-hmm. It's really not bringing a heck of a lot of benefit to you in that application. Right. On the other hand, certainly if you're on a monopod, and even if you're on a tripod, but hey, it's not the biggest and heaviest model in the world of tripod. It's kind of windy out here. The boardwalk here at the beach has got a little bit of flutter to it. Image stabilization may help you then.
Okay, I was just curious. Good to know. Thanks.
Okay, now we do have another Twitter question. And say that.
Say that 10 times. Uh-huh. Right.
And this one is actually, Rudy, a technical question about the 5DS image sensor. Is it the same image sensor technology as the 70D, but just a larger array of pixels? And if not, what's approved? And this is from HFS Pix. So HFS Pix, thank you for that question.
You mentioned the 70D in your question. And that camera, of course, is, I won't say unique, because the 7D Mark II also shares this. Those two cameras use dual pixel CMOS sensor autofocus. So the structure of the imaging sensor in those cameras is different from any other CMOS sensors we currently have in production for our digital SLRs. Now the 5DS and the 5DSRs do not have the dual pixel CMOS construction. So the short answer to your question is no, they are not the same technology in terms of just the pixel arrangement and so on. The final pixel size of 5DS is actually very similar to 7D Mark II and 70D in terms of just the size of each individual pixel.
But it's more than twice the area.
Right, exactly. You're talking a full frame sensor, of course, versus APS-C in terms of sensor size on the less expensive cameras. So short answer to your question is no, in this case, they are not the same sensor technology.
Okay, we do have one more Twitter question, and while our tech is getting that ready, I want to remind everybody that this webcast is going to be rebroadcast on a loop on B&H's YouTube channel and the Explora site over at B&H. And in fact, there are a lot of great things at the Explora website. I saw one of the very few interviews and interactions that I've seen of yours where you talk about your gear. Mm-hmm. And you talk specifically, it's a great read. If you'll go over there, you can find out about Gregory's lens choices and things that you thought about camera gear prior to discovering the 50.6 megapixel 5DS and 5DSR. Our final question from social media is from Danny Grizzle. This is, do these cameras exceed the capabilities of some existing EOS lenses?
Oh, that's another question that we frequently get, and I think Greg already gave us a terrific answer. You can use any Canon lens with these cameras. We've known for decades that if you're really, really ultra critical, some lenses are going to perform better in the lineup than others. That's something we've known since the days we were shooting film. Today in the digital era and now with a high resolution camera, that fact of life is no different. Sure, there are going to be some lenses, like some of these newer zoom lenses, that you can expect are going to give you a little bit more detail and contrast that'll be visible in 5DS or 5DSR files, perhaps, than a zoom lens that's a couple of generations old or something. But I'd be the last person in the world to tell you, hey, you know, you can only use the highest end new lenses or whatever. That's nonsense. You can use any EF lens you own. You know, and one of the beautiful things about this camera is that it has that total flexibility. Greg touched on that. You can put a lens as wide as an 11 to 24 millimeter on the camera. You can put a 600 millimeter lens on the camera. You can put anything in between on the camera, even if it's not the so-called high price sprit. So it offers some tremendous solutions for so many different types of work. You know, as I started to say before, this isn't just a landscape camera. This isn't just a studio camera. I could see action photographers using this lens. I've had team photographers from professional sports teams come to me and ask about the availability of this camera, because in many cases, they are asked to produce enormous printed output. Right. I don't mean just prints that are going to be on a wall, but enormous banners that are going to hang from the roofs of stadiums and such, of, you know, action pictures and this kind of thing. So they have, you know, clear reasons for this. The camera offers tremendous solutions for architecture, for instance, not only in terms of detail, but in terms of the tilt shift lenses, ultra wide lenses, again, like that 11 to 24, the 14 millimeter 2.8, the 16 to 35 lenses, just some tremendous solutions that this camera offers along with the lens system. So don't go into it thinking that, oh, I'm limited to just a handful of lenses. You can use any lens on this camera and produce some magnificent work.
Can I mention something just in fairness
Please.
About that? Because I think I understand. I appreciate where this question is coming from, for sure. This is just my opinion on this, but here's what I feel is that if what you want, and I'm not being facetious, if what you want is like nostril hairs or mustache hairs or beard hair, if you want that kind of eyelash of very good resolution, and that is what you're after, then you will want the latest glass, right? Because those lenses are exactly tuned, their resolution is such that they will give you that. I take pictures, have taken pictures, where basically, literally, the lens is slightly off the camera, and we do stuff like that. It's kind of like pre-lens baby. It's mm-hmm. kind of fun.
Sure.
That file will be a nicer file on this camera than it will with a smaller sensor, right? It won't be a multi-coded eyelash picture. It'll be a beautiful file that's very enlargeable. Do you know what I mean? But if what you want is the razor sharp thing, then you are going to want to get the lenses that will do it. Otherwise, you might be disappointed when you get to a certain point. It's like one of my favorite lenses that I use all the time is, I'm big on the tilt shift lenses, is the 24 tilt shift. When the second generation of that came out, it was wildly improved in my mind from the first generation, and I was pretty happy with the first generation until I saw the second one. So similarly, I felt like in that case, I needed to upgrade. I needed to get the newer lens that was actually more highly corrected. For those people who want that kind of image quality for those kind of pictures, then you need that tool to make it happen. I'm so
looking forward to, of course, you guys know I review a lot of cameras. I can't wait, because we've been outputting to, we have an IPF 8400, so the 44-inch wide Canon printer here, and it is absolutely amazing that the quality that you're able to get out of it, and I haven't even had any of these 50 megapixel images yet, so I'm really looking forward
to
printing.
You're in for a treat.
I'm really looking forward to some of my own prints and doing that. One of the things that I really enjoy about working with B&H, and this is very interesting, and it's very important that this comes across, every single question that was asked as a part of this broadcast will be answered by professionals at B&H. Even if we couldn't get to it here on the air, during the live, and obviously you can watch it back again in loop, but every single question that was asked will be answered. Now, one of the surprises that we have as a result of today's broadcast is that we are going to give away a copy of this book, Gregory. And you can, if you are not the person who wins, and we'll tell you who the winner is in just a second, you can actually pick this up at the B&H store, believe it or not, online or in person.
Or at my house.
Or at Gregory's house. And in fact, Gregory's home address is, and his cell phone number is. Okay, so our winner today is Daryl L. Hunter. And it's actually, it's on that screen, so if you want to make sure that you spell it exactly right. L-A-R-R-Y-B-E-C-K-E-R.
It's one R though, right?
Yeah. So let's make sure that it's spelled exactly right.
Because it's two different ways right there.
I know.
Want to make sure. We're going to double check, Daryl. We want to make sure we get it right. I'll do it in pencil. You can erase it and just fix it if I do it wrong.
So it's Daryl L. Hunter. Daryl L. with, that looks right. So congratulations. And you're going to be able to save this broadcast forever. Folks, I can't tell you how excited I am about the technology. Obviously, with the working professionals that are here as a part of this broadcast and answering your questions, we hope you've gotten just a taste of some of the amazing resolution that is now shipping and could be in your studio in no time. Thank you so much for joining us on behalf of Gregory Heisler, Heisler himself, Rudy Winston from Canon USA. I'm Larry Becker from Kelby One. Thank you so much for joining us.